Alright, this is John Cullen with GrowingYourGreens.com to have another exciting episode for you, and I'm still here in Kelowna, BC, British Columbia, Canada. Man, I love Canada this time of year. It is totally amazing here. We're here in August. Super cool, and you know, every time I come to Kelowna, I visit a buddy, Curtis Stone. You guys have watched Curtis. He has an amazing YouTube channel, an amazing program where he's basically teaching you guys and educating you guys all about agriculture, and trust me, when I watch Curtis's videos, I even learned some stuff that I didn't know, which is totally amazing. He travels all around the farms, probably even more extensively than me these days, because that's what he's pretty much doing full time, to basically share and spread content and knowledge for himself, but also to you guys, which is one of his most important missions in life. I'm actually at his home residence today, and actually this is his neighbor's house across the street. I want to just show a lawn, right? Dude, if you guys have a lawn like this, like, I seriously want you guys to grow some food. You have a huge opportunity. You have the space that's doing nothing to grow some food to feed you and your family. Curtis pulls out pounds and pounds, hundreds of pounds a year, freezes them, puts them up for the winter time when literally there's snow on the ground so him and his family could eat fruits, berries, nuts, seeds, and all kinds of things. So let's go ahead and flip the camera around and show you guys actually Curtis's place. Since I was here last year, man, he's only even made it better. Check that out, man. He's got this really cool arbor. Like, oh my God, I drove up and I'm like, man, that arbor's cool. Cause last year he had the fence. This year he put up the freaking posts. The arbor over top looks super pro. Plus, I mean, the reason for the arbor is because now he's putting wire in between them, which really is almost invisible cause you can't see it. And it's holding up and supporting all his berries around to create a living fence instead of stupid wood fence that's not alive, or even a metal fence that kind of looks gross. This is a productive fence, and he's been pulling, like, look, you guys see the goji berries? Tons of goji berries off. His kid comes out, picks goji berries every day. That's the kind of house I want to have when I have kids, and I want my kids to, you know, be able to come and pick goji berries in a safe, enclosed area without me having to worry about them, and, you know, having the kids be able to see where the food comes from and not eat all that processed foods, junk foods, and animal foods in excess that is, you know, normally eaten in our daily lives. So today, while I could give you guys a full-on tour of like how he's growing in the front yard, what he's growing in the backyard, and all this kind of stuff, I'm not gonna do that. Why? Because I did it last year, man. Check out the video link down below where I can basically go over Curtis's whole property. And this year, pretty much, I mean, yeah, he's growing different stuff. You know, his berry plants are freaking putting on more fruit than ever. Everything's doing great that I saw so far. I want to talk about another plant that I'm very passionate about that I believe all you guys, and especially if you guys are in Canada, you guys got to grow this plant, guaranteed. Curtis and I are both big advocates for this plant. And if it's legal for you to grow where you live, you guys should do so. So let's actually go back and hook up with Curtis, and we're gonna show you guys what this plant is and why you should grow it. All right, so now we're here with Curtis, and we have one of his favorite plants, and actually one of my favorite plants right behind us. And this is the plant that I feel, if legal to do so, you guys should enact your rights to grow this plant, because I feel that we should not be unable to grow any plant we want due to laws, for whatever reason the laws are made, especially when they can be quite beneficial, you know, even if we are told otherwise. So this plant is the cannabis plant. Now, whether that's the strain of a hemp plant that has zero THC or under 0.03 with high CBD value, whether that's one with, you know, a sativa or, you know, a hybrid plant or whatever kind it is, we should be able to grow this plant. Would you agree, Curtis, everybody should grow this plant if legal to do so? Don't do it illegally.
If you're into it. I mean, the one thing about cannabis is there still is quite a cultural stigma with it.
That's sad.
And it is sad, but hey, whatever. So if people are interested in that, you know, have at it. I must say I do have a lot of my subscribers or fans are, you know, there's some evangelical Christians out there, and I've had some people like send me hate mail essentially because they think that this is the devil's lettuce.
This was used in the Bible, right? Wasn't it?
I'm not super versed in the Bible, so I don't want to go ahead and say that. But those people don't speak for all Christians. So,
sure.
You know, whatever. I have hundreds of friends that are Christian around the world, and they don't give a toss about what a person does on their own time in their own space. So, but yeah.
So we both advocate this plant. I don't necessarily advocate the psychoactive effects that this plant is known for myself. I personally don't like feeling that. I can't tell you guys what to do or not do. but at least everybody should have access to this plant for its non-psychoactive and psychoactive effects if you so desire. I mean, this plant is totally amazing, and we're going to get into this episode, you know, the five reasons why you guys should really be growing cannabis if it is legal to do so in your area. So since I'm visiting Canada, since pretty much every day of my trip here, the first day I went to a farm, you know, and got some cannabis leaves, and I've been eating like 25 leaves a day, not getting any psychoactive effects. And these are basically THC like base plants made, grown for the bud, which people smoke, which then you do get the psychoactive effects. And, you know, people say, John, you're high in all your videos. I'm never high. Well, there's one video I was high actually, because I got high accidentally, and I want to film a video of me high because I want to watch back on it and see how I act when I'm high, because I was super high. But I don't do that. Like, that's just how
I've
I am.
I've heard that about you. It's funny, but I've never, you don't even smoke.
I don't smoke. Yeah, no, I'm not going to mess up my lungs. Now, here's the other thing. I did stop at a dispensary up here, one of the cool dispensaries, Indian dispensary, so supported the native people, which kind of got screwed in a lot of ways. But, you know, and I bought some bud. I bought bud. You know, yeah. I haven't bought bud, frick, since I was like in high school. No, college. Actually, in college, I actually got free stuff. I had a buddy that was good. So, but in high school, I bought bud, but I'm way over that. But I bought bud, but it wasn't THC, but it was 32 to 1 CBD to THC. And for those of you guys that know, you know, if it's at least probably maybe 8 to 1, or maybe 10 to 1, you're probably not going to get high if it's high CBD bud, but you'll get the other effects. And, you know, basically plants are chemical factories. They're amazing chemical factories. Why is this plant valued? Because people like the THC, because they get that psychoactive effect, mind opening, whatever you want to call it. I don't choose to do that. But there's so many other different powerful plant chemicals that every plant will make. I mean, a tomato can make up to 300 different plant metabolites, maybe even more if it has good soil. And, you know, these are the properties in plants that give us different effects. You know, they could be, you know, psychoactive effects. They could be health effects. They could fill our cannabinoid receptors. They could give us, you know, chlorophyll and minerals. They could do so many things. I mean, actually, the U.S. government has a patent on the neuroprotective effects of cannabis. And that means it actually protects your brain from, like, probably degeneration and all these things. And if you're not eating cannabis, you're not going to get this neuroprotective effects. But then to a big extent, a lot of different foods have different effects. So I encourage you guys to, you know, not discriminate against certain food groups or certain foods because of stigma, because of whatever. Do your guys' own research, right? If you guys aren't into cannabis, watch some documentaries on Netflix or, you know, Amazon, and educate yourself. Go to websites, you know, buy books and read about this. And I mean, you will probably see, like Curtis and I have learned, that, you know, cannabis is how the plant is used and how it's been demonized and why was it demonized. And that's all. We're not even going to get into that. We're just going to get into why you guys should grow it. So Curtis, yeah. Let's start off with reason number one.
Okay. Well, first I just want to say, as a preamble, maybe we'll just not worry about pandering to those that will be offended by it. I'm sure if anybody thinks we're devil worshipers,
they're going to turn it off now.
They're going to be gone. So let's just stop pandering to people who are offended by it. And I'm just going to speak, for myself, and if somebody doesn't like that, well, then that's their problem. But number one for me, we'll go through a lot of these, but the main reason I do grow cannabis is because I do smoke, and I have had I get a lot of positive effects of that. I'm not a heavy puff, like I'm not smoking in the morning and smoking all day. I'm probably maybe a few times a week kind of thing. And for me, I'm a 420 guy. I don't know where that I don't know what the significance of that number is, but there's something about that time of day that when I'm kind of almost wrapping up my day, I like to have a smoke every now and then, and I kind of get into a little bit of a zone that puts me in a state of reflection. And when I was a music composer and I was spent a lot of time doing that kind of creative work, it was really good for me because I might have been working on a piece of music all day, and then like not smoking, and then near the end of the day, once I'd accomplished the lion's share of the work, maybe 90% of the work, I might have a puff and get a second wind and feel re-inspired, and also tweaking my perception, see things that I missed. And that's one thing that I like about this. You know, like human beings throughout history and in every aspect of our life, we're always altering our perception. Right, we're having different experiences. Maybe it's adrenaline, maybe it's love, maybe it's connecting with a person through a deep conversation. We're always altering our perception to find different ways of seeing things. And I, honestly, I can tell you that cannabis has been an important part of my life for many years because of that. And I'm saying this to you not having smoked today. I'm not stoned going on John's channel. I wouldn't do that. I never smoke weed and do YouTube videos. That's something that's a private thing for me in my life, or with my family or whatever. Not that we're getting our kids to smoke weed. Not at all. But, you know, in our family, this is a plant that grows in the garden.
Yeah.
Right? This isn't, oh no, like, let's not tell our kids about this. They're too young to understand. We have another kid coming in October, but our daughter is too young to understand it, and it's just another plant in the garden, right? The number one would be the psychoactive stuff for me.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think my number one would be the health benefits for me. I don't like the psychoactive effect personally. And, you know, more power to people that want to do that. I'll never tell you guys what to do or not do. But, you know, to me, it's a valuable plant because it has compounds that other plants simply do not have that I want to get into. I mean, actually, when I started juicing it on a more regular basis several years ago when I had a medical card in California, you know, I felt it took my health to the next level. And maybe it's what you're missing in your life. That being said, I don't think cannabis is necessarily a cure-all. Like, if you have ails, the solution isn't eating cannabis or smoking it or however you're going to ingest it. It's to, you know, make dietary changes as a foundation. And yes, this also as an adjunct may be really helpful.
Yeah, and now, so are we going through my five or are we splitting them
up? I guess we'll split them up, man.
Okay, because, well, that would be my number two is the health. So the one thing I do with my cannabis plants is, like, I'm big into juicing. When John came earlier, I was showing him, like, I've got an entire bed of celery. So I've got, like, it started with 264 cores of celery. We're juicing all the time, and I'm trying to overwinter that bed so I have celery all winter to grow for myself. So we're big into juicing. My wife and I got into that medical medium diet, like doing hardcore celery juices, really for the winter too. That's important for us. But so we're juicing, and so what I do when I manage these plants, I actually start pruning a lot of the leaves off on the bottom to just kind of get some airflow at the base, which helps with, as we get into the fall, we start to get some more, we get a bit more humidity and precipitation, and that can cause some fungus issues. So I go in and I'm thinning plants out. I'm thinning out the big fans and stuff on the bottom. And I'm trying to cultivate a tree, kind of as you see here, where I've got one big cola, and then I've got kind of a few around, maybe 12 around. That's all I really look for. Everything else is just secondary. But we're big into juicing it. And so we're putting this into the Omega juicer, and we're just like, we do shots, just like a wheatgrass shot. And then the excess, because I actually got to prune a bunch of these, I'm going to probably prune out, like, it could be 10 pounds of leaf in the next few days here. I'm going to juice all that point, because I'm not going to let it sit, right? So we juice it, we'll consume what we want then and there, and then I'll freeze the rest. So I'll put it into ice cube trays, freeze it, and then once that's flash frozen, those will go into bags that we throw into our smoothies throughout the winter. But then we'll keep juicing throughout the season. But it's a fairly low... it's a short season, right? Like, it's kind of if you're doing outdoor stuff like this, it's a short window of time that you can do this. These were transplanted late, June 28th, which actually I'm finding I like that better than doing early, because if you go early, they get way too big, which once my food forest is done, that might be sweet. But so yeah, my number two is definitely the health of it.
Cool. Well, my number two is that it provides a lot of food fast. As he just said, these guys were literally transplanted in on the 28th, which at this point is about a month and a half ago. And look at these guys, a month and a half, literally 45 days, or like 3 feet tall. This plant is actually finishing for Curtis, since he does smoke. That's probably a good thing for me. I would just want leaf, so I could just keep using leaves, because I mean, my channel is called Growing Your Greens, because I want you guys to grow and eat every kind of green that is possibly edible for you guys, however you guys choose to process it and or use it.
Yeah, so I've got some other varieties. These are all different varieties that come to fruition at different stages. Certainly the some of these sativas go earlier than some of my indicas. Like, I've got one back there, I think it's a Moby Dick, it's huge. This is what the hell is this one? This is the Northern Lights. So this is a sativa hybrid, or sativa dominant, so it's an earlier one than some of the other ones I have. But I would say, so what was my number two is health. My number three would be, it's such an easy thing to grow. So it's kind of like...
Because you've grown vegetables now for like 10 years and all, have dealt with all kinds of pests and problems,
yeah,
right?
Like, it's an easy crop to grow in that you don't have to do anything to it. You can literally put it in the ground and it will grow. And that's it. Like, you don't have to prune them. You don't have to manage them. I mean, one thing a lot of growers do is they, I forget what it's called, but they top it when it's about three nodes high. So just like on a basil plant, you get like the first set of branches, that's what I call a node, and then there's another set of branches that's a node. People will prune their basil at sometimes about two nodes, and then you pick the middle, and then it starts to bush out. That's what a lot of people do with their cannabis, and that's probably what the majority of, I think, indoor growers do it that way. Outdoor growers want low maintenance because they don't want to spend time on labor, and that's kind of what I'm going for. But I like how the ease of this plant, I don't have to do anything, and it makes this nice tree. And then that's going to lead into some of the other benefits of reasons I grow it.
Cool. I think the third reason I think it's really good is, like as Curtis said, you know, I'm having similar benefits. I mean, it is called weed, guys. Why is it called weed? Because in like the Midwest, right, it just keeps coming up as a weed and you can't get rid of it.
Yeah.
And these are the best foods we want to grow, whether it's this weed or, you know, my dandelion weeds or my purslane weeds. Or my lamb's quarters chickweed weeds or the chickweed.
Yep.
I mean, these are, you know, there's so many different things that I grow that literally reseed on their own. They come back every year without me having to do any work. So this plant will save you guys labor and still provide you guys lots of food for medicinal and edible uses.
Yeah, and one thing to say there is, unlike most other plants that you would find in the wild, these won't reseed themselves. In that, the important thing about growing for bud, and it might not be the case for growing for leaf, it certainly wouldn't be actually, but for growing for bud, if you want to smoke it, yeah, you have to feminize, right? So you have to have no males present, because if there's any male plants present, that pollen will make its way onto these buds, and then we won't get the same type of psychoactivity and yield as you would if they're separated. So like when the plants are feminized, they essentially get really horny. That's essentially what's happening, and that's part of what makes these buds the way they are. But I would say my number four is the amount of biomass that I can produce in such a short time. Like, this plant is only 6 weeks from transplant. I transplanted it about this big, and at that point it might have been only 3 weeks old. So let's just say this plant is 2.5 months old. This is the smallest one I have here. But it's a ton of biomass. So, you know, next year, once I get my food forest more happening, this is going to be like my chop and drop crop. Mm. Like I'm big into the sort of Jeff Lawton idea of producing biomass to take some of that biomass and throw it on the ground. So my strategy there might be next year is cut out the biomass, juice the leaves, and then throw the stem and the big stuff on the ground to decompose and build up my soil. And so I like that fast biomass. You know, if I could do more of this, I would just have way more and just have some just for the sake of chop and drop, because these plants are almost indestructible. Like, you could just chop this down and it would just keep growing.
Wow, amazing. I think my number four would be, I mean, honestly, I love the smell. Like, that sounds weird, but, you know, I grow plants for my reasons, you have your reasons, and I mean, if you never smell, like, you smell bud and you'll smell, but even the plant smells like, it just smells amazing. It's like, you know, you walk out when I have my, because I don't grow cannabis currently until it's legal in the states where I live. So I just really love the smell. I don't know if it brings me back to my days in high school when I get high or something, or, you know, it's just
probably.
Like, or if I just, yeah, probably, but if I, that I don't anymore, or just like if I'm in like a citrus orchard and I smell the flowery perfume of the citrus, or, you know, if I go out to my basil and actually if I go out to my garden and I smell my flowering beets, the flowering beets, oh my God, they like have such a unique, interesting smell. I mean, it just gets me, oh, I have it on my fingers.
Yeah.
It smells so good. It's like essential oils, man. I mean, and it just like affects us, you know, to put that in our environment. I mean, it actually puts a smile on my face when I just smell it. And maybe that'll be the case for you. Maybe it won't. You know, I don't know.
Yeah. So I would say I'm going to do my number five and then just throw in a bonus. So my number five would be, it's such a low feeder. Mm-hmm. Like the plant barely pulls anything from the soil. And so in this context, in these raised beds, I didn't have I'm still not done my food forest area, because this was a high tunnel, because I've been kind of transitioning away from farming and just kind of getting more like John into homesteading and growing my own food. But I like that it's a low feeder, and like I said, it produces a lot of biomass, and then the bonus that's tied into that is in a food forest system, you can grow a lot of shade really quickly. And so one of the challenges we have up here is we get really long days, and we're in a high desert in the Okanagan region, which is similar to Vegas. It's similar to parts of Arizona, in that in the summer it can be punishingly hot, and we've had over 40 degrees Celsius, which is like, I think 40 is 105, I believe it's 105 Fahrenheit. We've been over 40 Celsius, so it'd be like 40. My thermometer on my deck in the shade read 45 Celsius, probably like 115 Fahrenheit, which is insane. So I haven't been able to come back here in the middle of the day. It's so hot. So what I'm stoked about to do next year is, once I have my food forest with my trees in here, and then I'll interplant cannabis in, because cannabis is very adaptable in where it can grow. Like, it can grow pretty good in shade. It doesn't need a ton of light. So I can have this near the trees that might get partial shade today. It'll still do fine, but then they'll create more shade so that my kids can come around here, have shade, and then this, we can kind of cool this area back down here, which is, I'm excited for. And then what that ties to with what I originally said was that it's a low feeder, is I can have all this stuff interplanted, and if I can start getting more into chop and drop, throwing biomass down the ground, this crop is actually a net positive, in that it's truly a regenerative crop, in that its externalities are positive. Whereas like something like corn, it has negative externalities. Corn is a massive suck on the soil, and it's been downgraded through genetics over so many years that corn barely provides any nutritional value. All corn grows now is sugar, essentially, for soda and other crappy products. So cannabis is this potentially this amazing regenerative plant, which I think going forward, we can switch more growers, especially in the Midwest. Like, I did a tour for my From the Field website this summer of the Midwest. I was in Nebraska, Iowa, Wisconsin. I was in Wyoming, Montana as well. It's like basically one GMO cornfield.
Wow.
And what's happening with the soil in all those areas? The thing that gets me excited when I start to think about ag, because that's ag is my passion, and trying to get farmers to embrace growing sustainably, but let's go beyond sustainable, let's go regenerative, let's make all of our externalities positive. I think this crop has the potential to do that unlike any other crop, because of the things we even talked about. Low feeder, massive amount of biomass, all the benefits you get from it. CBD, you get different types of fiber from the plant. You get a hardy fiber for things like rope and more industrial products in the bottom, and then you get a finer fiber which you use for clothes and things like that in the middle, and then you get your bud, which is either CBD or THC product. Plus, it draws nothing from the soil. So it's
barely
just
anything.
It's just you could just take some ground, some dirt, and put this in there, and you'll get a beautiful plant. There's no agricultural crops really exist that way, because we've been breeding agricultural crops for so long. And this is the neat thing about agriculture. I don't want to open a can of worms here philosophically, but agriculture essentially makes things weak. And I would even go so far as to say agriculture makes society weak in some ways. Wow. It's like compare a cow or a sheep that's been raised agriculturally for thousands of generations, that animal's not getting stronger. Whereas a wolf in the forest, that is an animal that's adapted to survive. And the harder its life is, the more successful it's gonna be. Whereas that's where we've split it off. And so I'm wondering, you know, we can't get rid of agriculture, and nor am I saying that we should, but I wonder if a plant like this might be a vehicle for us to start thinking about how do we make these things more resilient, and I would even say anti-fragile, in that how do we become stronger over time, and through punishing and testing the limits that make things stronger. How could we do that agriculture? This is a sort of a philosophical agriculture question I have, is like, how could we take the best parts of agriculture and then make ourselves stronger, make our plants stronger, make our food system stronger and not weaker.
More resilient.
Yeah, more, but it's beyond resilient. This is anti-fragility. This is kind of taking the Nassim Taleb idea of what doesn't kill you makes you stronger. You know, a glass is fragile. You drop it, it smashes. A plastic cup is resilient. You drop it, it doesn't do anything. But your muscle tissue is stronger, because the more that gets punished, the stronger
it
gets. Yeah, like this is kind of my philosophical struggle or desire to see agriculture and human beings become stronger, because I think the bigger our government gets, the more technology makes our lives more comfortable, the weaker we get as human beings. And that's happening on every front. And my passion is food and agriculture, and that's what it's doing to us, right? We've been geneticizing our food to be less nutritionally dense. Yeah. Whereas we have an opportunity with a plant like cannabis that's so new in the sense that, well, not new, but it's new in the sense that there's now a market access that we could do this, and now we've got so much research and development going into this plant. Like, they've discovered there's over 100 different cannabinoids.
Wow.
Right, so CBD is just one.
Yeah, of course.
Right? And so now the pharmaceutical industries are going like, holy crap, like, this is a miracle plant. We've all known that it's a miracle plant. Anybody who's been switched on to this has known this forever. And, you know, First Nations people here in Canada, there's record of them using this plant. This plant goes back thousands, maybe even hundreds of thousands of years to human beings. So we're now reconnecting with that. But yeah, as you can see, it's a rabbit hole. It's an interesting subject, and there's so much to the plant.
Cool. So I think my final thing is, you know, kind of similar but different. You know, it's that this plant is so useful. Like, this is one of the most useful plants. Like, if you're in permaculture and want to have stacking functions, this plant can do so many things. You know, you can provide shade. It grows fast. It doesn't need a whole lot of water. You know, it's pest resistant. But just from the uses, for human uses, once it's grown, I mean, the stalk could be turned into rope and cord. They make insulation out of this stuff. You know, the leaves are juiceable. Right. You could eat them as salads. You could, you know, smoke the buds if you want to. You could eat the buds like I do. You know, you could, oh my God, you could get the hemp seeds, and you could like have
hemp seeds.
Actually, I want to see you do, actually the problem might be illegal, but hemp seed sprouts or microgreens.
Yeah.
Oh my God, you could do like, you know, hemp seeds for the nutrition, for the fat, for the oil, for the good omega-3 to 6 balance that it has. You could make essential oils out of this plant. I mean, there's an endless amount of products that can be made from this plant, and it's been restricted for so long, which I think should be a crime.
Yeah, it is a crime. And I mean, but that's the world we live in, unfortunately.
Yeah.
I mean, that's one thing we didn't even really touch on is the seed. Like, and that's one of the problems, that if you want to grow for bud, you can't really grow for seed. And so that's kind of a conundrum. Because if I...
Depends what your goals are. Like me, everything would go to flower, go to seed. I would just harvest leaves. I'd be happy.
Interesting. You know, it might be interesting. Because I mean, I know that you can have buds that have seeds and it'll still get you high, essentially.
I don't really care
but
about that.
I'm just saying, is for people to understand, like, you know, I go down to Mexico a lot, and you know, you get like Mexican weed is notorious for being full of seeds. Still gets you high. It's kind of what we call like a ditch weed. That would be the name for it up here. It just kind of burns you out, and so you got to kind of keep smoking it. But you know, you technically could. It depends on your goals. But maybe you could get seed and smoke at the same time. So I haven't tried it yet, you know, because I am a big fan of seeds. Like, I buy from Manitoba Harvest, which is probably like the biggest Canadian hemp company here. I buy the seeds, and they go in every morning. They go in my smoothie. So that's
grow your own, man. Better.
Well, maybe I could. So maybe we'll have to see. That could be a further update.
That'd be the next thing, you know, is like it's the cannabis, which is the more medicinal plant, versus growing an industrial hemp that has a lot of the cannabinoids, maybe just without the THC. It's been bred without the THC, so it can be grown. Like, in the United States, federally, it's now legal to grow hemp, and in Canada, it's, you know, you could grow a certain amount of plants per person.
Yeah.
You know, and eat any variety, I guess.
Yeah, that's right.
What in Canada, is there kind of hemp laws, or does that kind of fall under the 4 plants per person rule?
I'm not sure with the hemp. I mean, the thing that's interesting about what's happened in Canada is that, like, no, before it was legal, everybody I know who's growing it, nothing changed. They were growing it before, and they're growing it now. It's just that it's made it a very monopolistic. It's just like anything. It's all about the money, right? Like, the government wants tax dollars from their flock. You know, my opinion. The government's a farmer, right? And we're just cattle that are farmed. And so the government always wants maximum output. You know, so it's just intensive farming, jam people in cities, and so on and so forth. It's sort of, I'm opening a rabbit hole there, but. That this is what's happened essentially is that they found a ways to monetize the tax livestock higher, and so they've made it legal, but it's super regulated in that there's a limit to what an individual can grow at home. But now they have regulated anybody that wants to get into the business. So what they've done is they've knocked down all the small producers to make room for the big monopolies, because they get more revenue from monopolies than they do diversified small. So I hate that, frankly. Like, I don't like big government. I don't like monoculture. You know, like, to me, big government's just monoculture. I like the idea, permaculture idea of diversity, small and diverse, resilience, anti-fragile built in the system. I don't like monocultures. And so I've seen the government do that with the hemp industry, which I don't think is going to be good in the long term. It's certainly like, it's a gravy train. People are making a ton of money at it, but I don't know if that serves the interests of the small producer, the family farm and whatnot, but you know, it is what it is. And people, we follow the path of least resistance and adapt to the circumstances and do the best we can with what we've got.
Yeah, so I would agree with you, Curtis, and I know the U.S. laws, I don't really know the Canadian laws, but in the U.S., like for the state I live, Nevada, you know, cannabis, recreational cannabis is legal, and the exclusion they wrote in, which I don't think even like Colorado, Oregon, Washington, they don't have this exclusion, which is if you live within 25 miles of a dispensary, you can't grow.
It's insane.
And so why, the only reason they did that is because they want it to run through the dispensary so they get the tax dollars. And here's the other thing that's interesting, right? I flew up here, actually it was a cheap ticket, it was like 80, 90 bucks each way. And actually the cannabis, according to a guy that I flew up with who does work at a dispensary in Vegas, the prices here are 2 to 3 times lower than in Las Vegas. So they're just gouging people. People come to Vegas to have fun, and now they can buy cannabis, and the government can make a shit ton more money that they're not even giving to the schools like they promised to when people voted on the laws, which is total BS. But anyways, hopefully you live in a better state than where I live, and you could actually exercise your right to grow. And then with the hemp laws, right? I know at least in the U.S. anyway, there are a lot of small producers. Actually, I just supported one. I went online and I want to get some CBD industrial hemp. So I bought actually CBD, trim. So, you know, bud trim, all the small stuff on the side. I paid $75 per pound. That's where the money is, guys. If you guys could start a legal hemp farm, and how you're going to know if you could do that is you're going to contact your local state agriculture office because they do the licensing. You know, some of the cooler states are up to date with the 2018 law that in the farming bill that just passed, which makes hemp legal. And you know, states like Nevada, they still have the old rules from 2016, 2015 on the books, which is like hemp is an experimental crop and it costs a ton of money to get a permit, and then you got to pay X per acre. But when the states start enacting the federal law, which makes it legal in the new way, it should bring that down significantly if the states are proactive and really want to build a new and better economy, in my opinion. And then you want to grow the industrial hemp that has been bred for high CBD. Like some of the industrial hemps could have 20% CBD, which is insane, but like next to no.
.023
in the US, THC, so you don't get high from it. And then I ordered actually popcorn bud, like the stupid buds that like people don't want.
Yeah, the little ones.
I ordered 1 ounce of popcorn bud. It was like $55. So like I spent $125 on like 1 pound.
People are selling
17
popcorn
ounces.
Bud?
Like, see, this is industrial hemp I bought online.
Wow.
So I could have access to this amazing food. And you know, I wish I didn't spend it online with the local grow, with a small farmer that's selling it online. But this is what you guys could do, and you could charge this amount. So I mean, yeah, microgreens really good for if you want to make a lot of cash. But if you could get a industrial hemp farming license and do it legally, grow high CBD, and you could sell it online and basically have access to the whole country.
Yeah.
Unlike if you're growing THC, you must stay within state, and it's so freaking regulated to the hilt because it is have that psychoactive effect.
It is. I mean, let's talk about hemp a little bit more. I mean, I was interviewing a farm down in Durango, Colorado, which I make most of my videos for a website called FromTheField.Farm now, which is like a membership site, and I do long form with experts. And so I was down at this farm called Clutch Hemp Co. And these guys had a really interesting model. This guy was actually a Patrick Kane, he's a doctor. He was a past student of mine, took my market gardening class and started this hemp company, and they're making tons of money. And the neat thing about hemp is all the stuff you said, it is less regulated, though it is still regulated.
Yes,
still,
of
you
course,
still got to look
course
at all that stuff. But if you just look at the market opportunity, it's huge because everybody is so distracted with the money that can be made on THC,
they're
which is big
it
money, but it's low margins actually.
Because there's so much competition.
But it's so regulated they could flip a regulation and put you out of business overnight. And the guy I was visiting, he actually had a story of that. But the neat thing about hemp, he was telling me, is like they had a really neat model. So they're going at a regenerative farming model, which is neat when you just like we talked a little bit about the plant itself. But what they're trying to do is actually regenerate the farmer. And so what they do is they they have this decentralized model. They do all their own genetics, and I visited two of their mother locations where they produce all their own mothers, and then they split those up, and then they put them into clones, and that's a good transplant in the field. They go to farmers that are growing like crap crops, like corn and soy, and they say, hey, how about instead of, because they're just growing that for commodity market, which is garbage for the farmer. You're lucky to make $1,000 an acre, and commodity price switches, boom, you're out of business overnight. What these guys did is they formed a hemp futures company. And so they first buy futures, and they go to growers and say, we'll buy your hemp at this price. And then they stockpile it into their processing facility and sell it. So it's buy low, sell high. But what they do is they go to the grower and say, hey, how about instead of growing these crap crops, you grow hemp for us. We'll provide you the genetics. So we'll show up at the plant and plant them. We'll plow your field. We'll wow. lay the irrigation. We'll plant the damn crop. All you got to do is manage it until we harvest. And then they come in with corn combines. Crop it, they get a low a heavy fiber for building stuff like hempcrete and things like that, and then they get a thinner fiber for clothing and stuff like that, and then they get the CBD for all the oils and CBD products they're making. These guys had a profit margin of 85%.
Wow.
That is unheard of.
That's
in business
insane.
And so the neat thing about this is, think about the opportunities in that we can regenerate the land, we can regenerate the farmer, and we can make a shitload of money at the same time.
Wow.
So like, it's win-win-win. So I just see so much opportunity in it. I'm doing my best to go and find more farmers that are doing this to tell these stories, because I have this fantasy of converting the Midwest, which is essentially turning into a dust bowl, and a lot of it is a dust bowl,
yeah.
into a green area where you can grow this crop. I mean, imagine this, here's a scenario, and I'm so abundant with my ideas, like, I would start a business doing this, but I'm going to throw this idea out there. Anybody can rip it off. What if you did this? You went to these big corn farms that are using center pivots and, or just they're just rainwater irrigation. They're doing this big ag with these crappy crops. You grow hemp, and then once your plants are about this big, you go and you seed an understory of pasture, and then you do regenerative grazing with cows, sheep, these animals build soil, right? They graze, they manure the land, and then, so you can have a win-win-win-win on all of this, and then you're building soil, the crop barely draws anything from the soil, then you have your pasture animals come, they eat all winter long, and then boom, next year you plant your rows out with hemp again. Like, you could actually do that. I don't know anybody that's actually doing it, because I was kind of riffing with my buddy down there talking about these ideas, but there's just so many possibilities on where you can grow. I think the next big thing is going to be hemp, because
yep.
everybody goes to the THC because they just see the gross numbers, which are gross numbers. That's the thing. Like, I've talked, not profiled so much. I did one YouTube a couple years ago, but I've talked to cannabis growers, and the margins are razor thin. If you got into the right time, which is not now, because now it's mainstream, everybody's going in. Now that big finance is going into it and taking the leap, everybody's going one way. I think the opportunity is hemp and CBD and going at that market, because it's way less competition, and the bonus is they need a lot of it. And you could do that. You could go to these 1,000-acre, 1,000-hectare farms and say, hey, do hemp. It's so easy, and you don't need to manage the plants at all. Like, you don't need, when you grow for cannabis and THC, there's a lot of management. There's a lot of labor on that plant. But when you're going for hemp, pretty much grow the plant, and then you harvest, and it gets all processed with machines. It is hard on machinery, but the margins are there. I mean, if you got an 85% margin, so what if your combines only last, you know, a fraction of the time as they would for growing corn? The margin's gonna pay for that.
Right.
So whatever.
Wow. I mean, totally agree. I mean, hemp is going to be the future, especially the CBD dominant and special strains that are grown for CBD, not just like standard hemp for seed or something. Because if you grow for CBD, you know, that CBD is a huge market. It is only getting growing because of the legal status in the U.S. anyways. I don't know about Canada, but and just all the other uses of the crop, you know, making shirts. I mean, this plant can be used in so many ways. You could sell this stuff to the people that make fabric. You could sell this to the food producers. You could utilize this stuff. You could sell the popcorn buds online. Like, I bought them for $55 an ounce for popcorn bud. I mean, that's not even good bud, man.
Yeah, no,
like,
exactly.
Come on.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's the kind of marketing, even if you just want to do it in a backyard. I mean, I love Curtis's philosophy of trying to convert big acreage, but I know, you know, some of you guys, it's kind of like your model, actually. Kind of thought back to the first video we made together in my yard,
where
using OPM, other people's land,
that's right,
to basically have your farm. And this is like basically getting farmers on board, and you basically almost kind of, not really manage them, but kind of manage them, because they're growing the hemp for you, and then you come in and just make everything work and make it happen. So really, you don't even have to have any land, maybe some kind of processing facility,
that's
or maybe even you know, sublease or use a processing facility when on their off time. Totally amazing, you know. So you're kind of thinking big picture. I'm just thinking, man, just a guy and his, you know, I met a girl just a couple days ago. I'm like, I'm telling her, she's like, I have a big greenhouse in Jamul in California. I'm like, what should I grow? I'm like, you got to get a hemp license and grow CBD hemp, man. And like microgreens, like do things that people aren't doing. I like the no competition. Plus, I know the health benefits of the plants are there.
That's right.
I mean, I go to the health food trade shows every freaking year, and CBD is just getting bigger and bigger. But you know, some of the crap you buy at the health food store, I mean, they're using CBD isolate. So they extract the CBD through some chemical process. They have a white crystal powder. Then they basically put that in coconut oil. Then they basically sell it as CBD, you know, on the bottle. And basically, you're getting an isolate. And I want to eat the whole food form of the plant, you know, whether you want to alcohol extract it, CO2 extract it, you know, or just juice it and freeze dry it. I mean, that's probably the best way that I'm in Canada, yeah. I like to, you know, enjoy all the leaf and CBD bud that I can until I go home. So as you guys can see, both Curtis and I are both super fired up about this, and that's why I wanted to make this video for you guys. Like, you guys got the double whammy, and hopefully you guys come walking away with this video with maybe some business ideas, you know, opening your mind to the cannabis plant and both the psychoactive and non-psychoactive,
yep,
you know, benefits of this and financial benefits that could be an opportunity for you to, you know, make you guys aware, because this is like below the radar for most people, since we're like, we're in this industry and we work with this stuff all the time.
Totally.
Any final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share, Curtis, this specific topic?
Yeah. I mean, just if you're curious about it and you want to grow it, just start. It's quite literally, I've grown probably 100 different types of vegetables and fruits and all that, and cannabis is I can guarantee you, is the easiest thing to grow out of all that. So if you're one of these people that's not freaked out and doesn't think this is the devil's lettuce, and you can look at it objectively as a beneficial plant with a lot of great characteristics, grow it. Because it's easier to grow than tomato. It's easier to grow than a radish. It's so easy. You can put it in the most marginal soil and it will grow. And so, yeah, if you're not gonna get arrested for it and you're open to it, just start. Just get some seeds. Start. I do everything from seed. I know a lot of people, they get clones. I do everything from seed. So I get, you know, just get seed from local area here, no problems there. I also do a lot of auto flowering. You know, a lot of people, this might be one thing to just add on the end.
Yeah, so like for the winter, you grow this inside,
yeah,
right?
So I've got a passive solar greenhouse here, a hybrid passive solar, and I can do a crop in the winter without any extra light. So we get down to like less than 8 hours light at our solstice, but I'll start some stuff in late January. I do what's called auto flowering, which are neat little plants because they actually might be the future, and they're totally open pollinated. A lot of people think they're hybrids. They're actually open pollinated. It was a variety that was found in, I think, Russia or something like that. But most cannabis plants, they follow the light cycle. So once you approach your fall equinox, the reduced daylight hours triggers the plant to start budding, like this is now, because we're approaching our fall equinox. The daylight hours are declining. Auto flowering plants, they just have a set DTM, so like 70 days to harvest. And so I did a bunch of plants in my greenhouse. I did 4 different varieties in my greenhouse this winter, and I cropped out in late April.
Which is
crazy. Without you know, I had a bit of external light to start them and get them going, but then once I had, you know, over 8 hours of daylight, I just kept them in the greenhouse in pots and just got a full crop. I mean, of course, a lot lower, like the plants would be like this big, but that might be something you would want to start with as an auto flowering, because it's really easy. It's a short cycle, low maintenance, and you get something right away. And so I like plants that I can do many times. It's part of the reason why I learned a lot early in farming, is that I really specialized in fast cycle crops, lettuces, radishes,
turnips. He's the expert, man, on that stuff.
And the cool thing about that is, like, if you do fast cycle crops, you see a full life cycle every week for like 35 weeks, whereas if you do potatoes in a growing season, you might only see two, right? So there's a lot of benefit in seeing a full plant cycle because you learn and absorb a lot. And I'm all about just like the absorbing that experience. And so maybe start with an auto flowering variety because you can do it so quick. And then like, that's what I do. I do some auto flowering early in the season. And that's actually how we kind of play with the legality. Mm-hmm. So in Canada, we can only have four plants legally, but I had four plants from January to April. Those were done, and then I started these after, so they're different timelines, right? So I'm hoping that isn't enough legal gray area that's gonna get me in trouble, but you know.
Because technically at any one time you had
four plants. I only had four plants at any given time, right? So that's how, so I did that. So I could do the same thing. Like, this guy's gonna crop out in probably a month.
Cut it down and then you get a new
one. I could technically do some auto flowering again in the greenhouse going into winter. So with that, you know, if you can legally in Canada only have four plants at a time, maybe you can actually have 12 because you can have four in the spring, four in the main season, and then once those
well,
are done.
Well, that's at one time because they're not alive
yeah,
anymore.
Yeah, there's only ever four at one time,
right?
Yeah, right? Yeah, but sure. You could have three cycles essentially. Sure. So there's some ideas there.
Yeah, cool. So, I mean, once again, Curtis is talking about growing for bud. I would encourage you guys to grow for leaf, which people growing into bud don't want leaf or don't want seed.
Well, I like that stuff too, though.
Yeah, well, yeah. So anyways, there's different ways to do it, and don't think, oh, I got to do it for this or this. I got to grow for, if you want to grow for bud, hey, grow for bud. If you don't care like me, I don't really care. I just want the freaking leaves. And I got high for 10 hours on raw cannabis leaves. Videos down below. You know, not only did I do it on me, but I did it on my friend who, I have low tolerance for THC. My friend has very high tolerance for THC, and I made the same exact concoction for him and stoned him out of his mind for 10 hours, even though he normally smokes. And I'd much rather people drink green juice to get the high effect if that's what you desire. It lasted for 10 hours, and my friend just loved it. I didn't particularly care for it. But yeah, the video's down below. Follow it exactly if you want to get the exact same results as I did. And I did it more than once. I did it twice, and after the second time, I'm like, I'm not even going to mess with anything similar to this recipe again because... for me, it's just not a fun experience. But I guess also, too, is that it's kind of like if you have a kid and you want to learn about how alcohol is not good for you, feed them like a six-pack so they get drunk out of their head, they throw up, and they're never going to want to do it again. Like, I had so much. It hit me so strong because I just didn't have, like, one puff. I had so much edible, and it went into me. I wasn't expecting it and just freaking blew me out. That really makes me not want to do it.
See, I'm the same way with edibles. Like, I can't eat edibles. It's like mushrooms. I just go down a rabbit hole, whereas smoking is more just a mild tweak of my perception. With edibles, man, I can't do it. I'll be in the fetal position on the floor begging for mommy. Like,
That's how I was. One day I ate a raw bud, a THC bud. One of my viewers, maybe you're watching, how I was in San Diego, give me a bud like this long, that fat. And like most people would be like, I just ate it. Like, John, you're crazy to eat a whole bud. And number the other thing is that you can't get high on raw bud. You didn't decarboxylate it. Well, I ate it with avocado and artichoke hearts before a flight because I can't take it on the airplane between the two states that it is actually technically legal recreationally in. So I ate it and I was like, I'll be all right. I'm eating it raw. I'm not heating it up. I'm not decarboxylating it. Loaded the plane, had all these bags I was taking back full of produce on the plane. And I was on the plane and just sitting through the flight. And I was like, maybe halfway through the flight, we're gonna land in 30 minutes. I start feeling weird. I'm like, crap, this is not good. Once again, highest of my life. And all I had to do is tell myself, because I was like, not in a fetal position, but I was freaking out in my head. Like, the government is poisoning me. I don't know. But then I really knew, like, I just got high. Don't worry about it. And I just had to keep, my mantra was, everything is gonna be okay. Everything is gonna be okay. Everything, I just kept saying that in my head. Repeat it. Because otherwise my brain would go all these freaking places and I'd freaking freak the hell out because I'm feeling just totally, I mean, not how I like.
Right.
And then I had to deal with all my heavy luggage and get off the plane. And then the best $5 I've ever spent, trust me guys, I bought one of those roller carts and I'm so damn cheap, I'll never buy those stupid roller carts for $5 to push your luggage. But I had, like, you know, 200 pounds of luggage. And then also I put my luggage on after I got to the carousel and it held me up. So I walked out and I freaking didn't fall over. Best $5 ever spent. Anyways, with that, hilarious. Curtis, if somebody wants to learn more about you, I know your program, you do so much good educational work on, you know, you give a sample for free on your channel. And then you have that, your from the fields program thing with intense long videos that, you know, if I went to a farm, I'd just provide for free. But I know you're on your own path. I'm on my path. And your videos are quite detailed. And I do recommend people highly if that's the way they want to go with farming and creating income and even learning money.
Yeah.
I mean, or learning and getting educated. Yeah, they should check you out. So how do they do that?
So, just one thing on that real quick. Like, I've made content for free for 10 years, since 2013 and all that. I have a book, The Urban Farmer, which actually you really helped me get out, so I got to thank you again for that first video. I did with you in Santa Rosa. But now I make content for this website called FromTheField.Farm, and it's not for everybody. It's basically $10 a month or $100 a year, and that money allows me to travel to experts in all the corners of the world that I couldn't do if I was just doing it on my own dime. And so my mission is to provide high value education for people that value the education. So this site isn't for people who just want to learn and check out farming. This is for people who really want to explore entrepreneurialism on the regenerative and sustainable agriculture side. And so I go to visit farms and I make really long videos where I follow an expert, and I'm barely on camera ever. I mic up a person and I follow them around and we learn everything about their operation. And so it's worth the money if you want to do it. But I'd like to just make an offer to your audience if that would be okay.
Yeah, wonderful, man.
So
I'll
give you, maybe we'll put in the show notes or something, I'll give anybody who wants to check it out 30 days free.
Wow. You guys should all do that. I'm going to say, so do that 30 days
sign
free.
Up
no for, brainer.
Sign up for free. If you don't like it after a month, no problem. But I'll give you guys, anybody watching, 30 days free. They can check it out and then see if they like it. I guarantee if you're serious about farming, you're going to get $1,000 of value out of that free month. So I'll give that to you. We'll put then the link. And then that's FromTheField.Farm. So that's my membership site. I normally only open it with like a registration every quarter. So it's closed right now. But if you follow this link, you can go in and check it out and become a member. And I mean, I'm on YouTube as The Urban Farmer. I'm sure John will link to my channel there.
It's all down below to his website, his YouTube and everything.
And so,
I support Curtis in his mission and what he's doing we're just trying to change the world, man.
Yeah, we're just trying to help people get into this. I mean, I own a tools company in California now, too, but I don't need to go on all about that. People can find out these things about me on my channel. But, I'll leave you those links. And if anybody wants to come check me out at FromTheField.Farm, they can do that.
Wonderful. Yeah, and once again, I encourage you guys actually to take advantage of the free 30 days. Thank you for doing that for my audience, Curtis. It's much appreciated because, I gain lots of knowledge from just watching some of your free ones because I'm not actually a member yet. Maybe we could talk about that.
Oh, yeah, I'll say,
but, this guy spreads so much good. I mean, I learned just in one of his videos the other day because I was watching him. It's like he went to a farm and,
Andrew Manns.
Yeah, man.
That guy.
There's like the castor bean plant is a good interplant for bell peppers because it attracts the predator that eats freaking thrips, which actually I have in my garden. So, but castor beans are so toxic, you shouldn't plant them. They're not good. Well, they're actually good, man. So every plant has some benefit, and it's only when you get to go to experts that I don't get to go to because you travel a lot more than I do these days.
Yeah.
And we could learn these things from people actually doing this stuff for real, not just reading it out of the book or finding some internet website saying so. I mean, if they're doing it year after year, there's a reason, and that's what you reveal to people.
And
so that's
amazing.
That
guy, Andrew,
that
guy's a two 1-hour videos. That dude, Man's Organics in Coaldale, Alberta, absolute gold mine. Regenerative, large-scale farming. This is what I'm talking about, man. Like this is what I'm trying to show people is there's so many ways we can have win. Endless wins, building soil, regenerating the farmer, regenerating people's health. Like there's so many things we can do. That's what I'm trying to show people, but I gotta travel to do that, and these things have cost.
Yeah.
So, anyways, I'll leave it there. And thanks for visiting me, John.
Oh yeah, man, a pleasure every time, man. Once again, I always support you. Encourage you guys to check out Curtis's work. You know, I mean, we're doing similar stuff, but totally different. And you're gonna learn from everybody. And I want you guys to have actually multiple teachers because each person has a different personality, and you'll learn something different on. And if you could just learn one thing from Curtis's thing, hey, great, you learn one thing in this video, two things in that video. I mean, it all adds up to that. Even if you're not farming on an industrial scale or gonna never do that, you could just take things that they're doing on a massive scale and incorporate them into your, to make sure that you guys have the most nutrient dense, most regenerative soil in your area and, for you and your family. So great work. Once again, I always enjoy visiting you, man. So thank you once again
always
for having
a pleasure,
me, even.
John.
Okay, so that's pretty much for this episode. If you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. If I get 1,000 thumbs ups, I'll come back next year for sure to visit Curtis. I mean, I love visiting this guy. I'm always learning stuff from him myself personally. And, I'd like to be here again next year. So thumbs this video up. Also, be sure to share this video with somebody else that may not be educated about cannabis and hemp and why it is such a valuable plant to grow and use in the ways you see fit. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes. I've been coming out every 3 to 4 days or maybe every week now, so you don't miss out on my videos and you never know what you're gonna learn. And make sure you click the little bell so you get notified, because I think YouTube unbells people sometimes.
Absolutely.
So you get notified as my new videos come out, so you don't miss any single episode. And finally, be sure to check our past episodes. The past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. Over 1,400 episodes, all for free on YouTube for you guys to watch anytime you want to learn more about growing your own fruits and vegetables and farm visits and all the things that I learned. I get to share vicariously on YouTube for you guys. So I guess with that, my name is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.